Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salamu ala nabiyyihi wa mustafa. Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah. Wa ba'd, your viewers everywhere. Welcome to a new episode of Ask Huda. This is a pre-recorded episode to answer the email questions that I received on my Facebook page. The first question is from Yusuf Muhammad. He said, is it permissible to refuse the obligatory military service in countries like because they are killing innocent people? Sometimes I would eliminate names. And this is better. I would rather give a general answer because it benefits here and there. So the question is, sometimes when you have to serve in an army, and this army is either fighting against Muslims or killing innocent people, what is the ruling in this condition? Some people would say it is under the category of ikrah, being forced. You have no choice. We'll discuss this inshallah. But of course, we should not skip the reference of Surah An-Nisa with regards to killing innocent people and the fate of the murderers and the killers in ayah number 93 of chapter number 4. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمُ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا. Do me a favor and count with me the felonies and the consequences of killing an innocent believer. وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا. It's a very important term. مُتَعَمِّدًا, deliberately. Whoever kills a believer deliberately. فَجَزَاؤُهُ, then he's the recompense. Number one, جَهَنَّم, the fire of hell. This is the beginning of the punishment. جَهَنَّم. Number two, خَالِدًا فِيهَا. Eternally, he shall reside in the fire of hell and dwell in it. وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ, and Allah is angry with him. وَلَعَنَهُ, and Allah curses him. Or actually in the past, cursed him. وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا, and he has prepared for him a great torment, greater than dwelling eternally in the fire of hell. And all of that simply for killing an innocent person deliberately. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah the Almighty says, مِنْ أَجْلِ ذَٰلِكَ كَتَبَنَا عَلَىٰ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ أَنَّهُ مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. This ayah came to crown the story of Qabil and Habil, the two sons of Adam, when Qabil killed his brother. Allah ordained in the scripture which he revealed to the children of Israel, to Musa alayhi salam, whosoever killed an innocent soul, any soul, any soul, any human being, any ethnicity, any background, any gender, but innocent, whoever killed an innocent person out of oppression or corruption on earth, he will be as if he had killed the whole mankind. فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. This is how severe it is to kill an innocent person. And Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his farewell speech, said, when he asked about the city of Mecca, which city is it, the day of Arafah, then the month of Dhul Hijjah, and he confirmed these days. He said, indeed, your blood, your honor, your wealth are as sacred as the sacredness of this day, the day of Arafah, in this month, the month of Dhul Hijjah, in this city, the city of Mecca, which is the most sacred city on earth. So no one could say, well, I have been given orders to shoot that person because he is a protester, or because he is making a revolution, or for a reason or another. This person is innocent and is not raising weapons, and he is not a murderer. How dare you are to kill him or take his life, then blame it on others. Said, I'm just a soldier. Subhanallah, in Surah Az-Zukhruf, maybe in Ayah 54, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Pharaoh, فَاسْتَخَفَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَطَاعُوهُ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ فَاسْتَخَفَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَطَاعُوهُ. He said to the Pharaoh, said to his people, I am your Lord. They bowed down. He incited them. He said to them, kill the children of Israel, kill their sons. They obeyed him. Chase Musa, they obeyed him. Follow him in the sea, they obeyed him. As a result, they were worthy of the punishment, not only in this life. They were drowned in addition to the awaiting punishment eternally in the far off hell. النار يعرضون عليها غدوا وعشيا ويوم تقوم الساعة أدخلوا آل فرعون أشد العذاب. سورة غافر. They're being punished in their graves, even those who are drowned. They're being punished in the sea, yes, morning and evening, constantly, 24/7, until the day of judgment. Will they take a break then? No. Then on the day of judgment, admit the Pharaoh and his people into the worst of punishment. Can they come and say, we were just soldiers? We were ordered by our master, by our general, by our commander, by our first lieutenant, by whatever. You and him are in hell. Did you get it? Simply because had it not been you, you are his arms. A person cannot use all the machine guns at once and cannot kill hundreds of people at once, but he has to have a manpower. This manpower, without this manpower, he could not kill people. So you are the means of oppressing people. Whatever happened with the Pharaoh, whatever happened in any nation that transgressed against others, these soldiers who said that we are mukrahin, we are forced. Ibn al-Arabi al-Maliki, the great scholar, said there is no difference between the scholars of Islam that if a person is forced to kill another, that he is liable, him and the person who forced him. You cannot say, at a gunpoint, I was ordered to kill somebody, I killed him to save my life. Why? Do you think your life is better than the murdered person's life? Do you think so? So you both are liable. And subhanallah, how much we're missing the great ruler, Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he ordered 7 people from Sana'a, from Yemen, to be executed. Qasas. Why? Because they participated in killing a young boy, Ghilatan. When he was reviewed in this ruling and verdict, claiming that only one person took his life and the rest planned, arrested, plotted, assisted. He said, if all the Yemeni people have participated in killing this one kid, I would have killed them all for him. Subhanallah. Justice. You do not draw the blueprint and blow those people here and poison those people here and starve those people to death here and imprison those people here until they die. And you say, well, I never pulled the trigger. Oh, yeah, you're right. You never pulled the trigger. But you give the order to kill all those people.
And those who are your assistants, whether high-ranking officers or low-ranking soldiers, they are all responsible as well. Imam Ahl Sunnati, Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, may Allah have mercy on him. When he was thrown in prison, his cell guard asked him, "Ya Imam," he believes this guy, this Imam, is a great Imam and righteous person. He said, "Am I being considered like assisting the wrongdoers and the oppressors?" He said, "Of course not." So he felt better. He said, "You are the wrongdoers themselves. You're one of them. You're one of the oppressors. Their assistance is the bakery, the person who sew their clothes, iron their clothes, delivers their food. But you're one of them. You are an immediate zalim." I do remember one of the shuyukh was telling me how much he was tortured in prison by some of these regimes. And he said, "The guy who used to beat me up and used to torture me, used to tell me, 'Please forgive me. I am just ordered to do it.' Yeah, he loves him for the sake of Allah. He feels sorry, but he beats him with no mercy. What kind of animal is he?" So it is not permissible. Al-mukrih wal-mukrah, the one who forced and the one who's forced to hurt or to kill, both are liable. Kedeer Muhammad says, "I am a lecturer at various universities. I gave a lecture for an engineering economics course which deals with teaching students how to calculate interest. Is this permissible? I'm afraid this is one of the means of assisting in achieving what is haram. Unless if these mathematics and calculations are needed for not just calculating the interest in general. And meanwhile, you elaborate to the students that dealing with interest is haram, charging and earning interest is haram, and provide them with the reasons, with the proofs, and also give them references if you're not really educated in this field. Mashallah, you're a university professor, and I truly appreciate that you're very keen to stick and adhere to the halal. Your job is 100% halal. Make sure that to eliminate any traces which could mess up or pollute this very decent job." So in your lecture, as I said, if there's something that fits to cover a variety of calculations, not only interest, when it comes to interest, you have to clarify to the students that dealing with interest is absolutely haram and what is the alternative. Brother Omar Mumtaz, Omar says in his question, "Is it permissible to read Quran without ablution, or must I make an ablution first?" If you read it by heart, it is not a must, but it is always recommended. It is always better to be in a state of tahara, ablution, from major and minor sins, impurities, and also and sins as well, of course. And only when you come to touch the Quran or hold it, the vast majority of the scholars say that you should have wudu, which means there is another opinion. But reciting the Quran by the heart does not require wudu, it is just recommended. So if you're driving, if you are in the bus, in the train, in any means of transportation, and you don't have wudu and you memorize some parts of the Quran, you want to recite them by heart or revise them, yes, you can do that. Rasha Abu Enaynae. Sister Rasha says in her question, "Is it permissible to accept welfare in a Western country even if we need it?" If you need it, yes. Of course. Why? Because this is a system that is put together by the state in their constitution. There is an agreement to a halal issue. It's lawful. In the Muslim state, before, when there was justice, which is absolutely missing today, there was what is known as Baytul Mal al-Muslimin. Baytul Mal is like the welfare bank which provides for all the poor, it collects donations, obligatory charities, zakah, and otherwise is deposited there, and they have the list of the names of all the needy ones and the disabled ones, the orphans, the widows. Their support is due upon the Muslim state. Why do we charge people zakah? خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّهِمْ بِهَا. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, to be taken from the rich, given to the poor. So if you are jobless, a widow, an orphan, a single mother, supporting family where your earning isn't enough, it is legitimate. What is not legitimate, and which is very broad and very common, people faking documents in order to take the welfare from the state. Or people who are capable to work and they say, why work? Why make effort if I can get paid and the state will pay for my housing, for my utilities, and I don't have to pay any tax, paying for my medication and everything. So this system is deficient because it creates lazy people. People who have the power to work, but they choose not to. In Islam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلْيَدُ الْعُلْيَا خَيْرٌ مِّنَ الْيَدِ السُّفْلَى وَأَبْدَأْ بِمَنْ تَعُونَ. The upper hand is better than the lower hand. Better, dearer to Allah, loved by Him. The upper is the one which gives, and the lower is the one which takes. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it will be better for you to take your rob and go to the forest, collect some logs and sell it, earn out of that like a laborer, and eat from your earning, from your hard work, than asking people whether they would give you or not. So in Islam, it appreciates work, it appreciates making effort, but if you're handicapped, if you're disabled, if you fit as an eligible person to receive the help from the state, it is 100% legitimate and enjoy it. Sherry Barry. Sister Sherry says in her question, is it permissible to listen to nasheeds about Islam which does not have music? Yes, it is permissible. Muhammad Azhar says in his question, what does the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mean? Does it include non-Muslims? There's something called ummatul da'wah wa ummatul ijaba. Ummatul da'wah is every human being, Muslims and non-Muslims, atheists, enemies of Islam, every person, Jews, Christians, every person, Buddhists, Hindus. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ لِلنَّاسِ كَافَّ. In another ayah, for all mankind, no one is exempt from the da'wah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why all human beings and the jinn are called أُمَّةُ الدَّعْوَةِ, the subject of the call to Islam, the da'wah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then those of them who accept Islam and they comply, they become ummatul ijaba. They responded, they complied, they became believers. Abu Sa'd in his question says, how can I make my intentions right and only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I'll give you a hint because we have only 1 minute. How many times, how often the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من, for instance, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا, من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا, من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا. This is how you sincere your intention. Why are you doing this deed? For Allah, because He said, do it. And as far as the expectations, what do you expect? A reward from Him, from Allah alone. You're not expecting any praises, showing off, admiration from people? Yes. Well, this is called sincerity. Once you involve any of these violations with your intention, that really ruins your intention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. Those who show off with their prayer, they will be punished rather being rewarded for the prayer. فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَهُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ. Because they show off. And the person is constantly in need to sincere his intention, purify his heart and his soul, because this is something which requires regular maintenance before and during and even after doing the good deed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us sincerity. Last but not the least, there is a beautiful dua in this regard. Lest that your intention may have been interfered with some, you know, corrupt intentions or show off or riya, which is to say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika shay'an a'lamu wa astaghfiruka lima la a'lamu, which means, O Allah, I seek refuge with you against committing shirk with you knowingly, and I seek your forgiveness for having done so unknowingly. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika shay'an a'lamu wa astaghfiruka لما لا أعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech, keeping my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test.